Coruscant, lower levels, 10 standard years after the Yuuzhan Vong War.
The object of her desire was walking down the opposite side of the sky lane, moving along a pedwalk so choked with vines and yorick coral that even the zap gangs traveled single file. He was 2 levels below and 10 meters ahead, and he kept stopping to study door membranes and peer into the windows of coral-crusted buildings. Then he would just stand there in the gloom, alone and empty-handed, as though no Jedi need fear the dangers of the Undercity, as though he ruled the twilight depths down where Coruscant changed to Yuuzhan Tar. Jason Solo was as arrogant as ever, and this time it would be his undoing. The angle was perfect, almost too perfect. If she struck now, he would be dead almost as soon as he hit the pedwalk. Nobody would know that his death had been an execution, not even Jason. But Alima Rar needed them to know. She needed to see the shock of recognition in Jason's eyes when he collapsed, to feel his fear burning in the Force as his heart cramped into an unbeating knot. She needed to hold him dying in her arms and suck the last breath from his lips, to hear his father roaring curses, and watch his mother wailing in grief. That last part, Alima needed more than anything. She had spent years pondering what she could take from Leia Solo that would be the equal of everything Leia had taken from her. An instep and 5 toes? That would be a fair trade for the half of a foot Leia had cut off on Tanupe. And the princess's eyes and ears would do for the Leku she had severed aboard the Admiral Ackbar. But what of the giant spider sloth to which Leia had fed her in the Tanupian jungle? How was Alima to match that? Because this was not about revenge, not about cruelty. It was about balance. The spider sloth had nearly killed her, had bitten her almost in half and left her slender dancer's body roped with white scars. An ugly, lopsided thing that only a Rodian would desire. Now Alima had to take something equal from Leia, something that would shatter her to the core. Because that's what Jedi did. They served the balance. Eager to keep her prey in sight, Alima hurried back toward the nearest pedestrian bridge. This region was teeming with ferals, the half-wild survivors of the Yuuzhan Vong invasion, who continued to live a primitive existence deep in the Undercity. She started across the bridge. Her Leku stump began to nettle, and she wondered if someone was watching her. Jason was nowhere to be seen. She drew her lightsaber and advanced up the pedwalk, half expecting to feel the emitter nozzle of a lightsaber pressing into her ribs just before Jason activated the blade. The most dangerous thing Alima met was a foraging scrat pack, which skittered away into a tangle of slash vines almost as soon as she saw it. The only other oddity was the sporadic team of ferals disappearing through a door membrane near the corner of the building. They were of many species, Bith, Bothan, Hodin, and they were all bearing the carcasses of dead animals, including hawk bats, granite slugs, a few slimy yanskaks. Once there was even a Shevin clutching what looked like a dead Ewok in its huge claw. They were probably just ferals returning home with the day's hunt, but as Alima passed in front of the doorway, she kept her lightsaber at the ready. No one leapt out to attack her, but she sensed a trio of Force presences on the other side of the membrane. Alima did not bother to investigate. Had it been Jason lurking behind the door, she would have sensed nothing at all. Instead, she exchanged her lightsaber for a short blowgun and armed it with a small cone dart from a sealed container in her utility belt. She had 8 more such darts, one for each of the Solos and the Skywalkers, plus 2 extras, all fashioned from the stinger and venom sac of a deadly Tanupian wasper. Alima raised the blowgun to her lips and stepped around the corner, her body already purring with the sweet tingle of murder. But Jason seemed determined to disappoint her. The pedwalk was empty and dark, and there was not a sentient soul in sight. There was no ambush. The only danger Alima sensed was the same faint tingle she had been feeling since before crossing the bridge. Alima returned to the door she had just passed, the one all the ferals had been entering with their carcasses. Dark and ringed by a thick crust of yorick coral, it looked more like a cavern mouth than a doorway. She pressed a nerve bundle on the door jamb, and the membrane pulled aside. Standing opposite her was a brawny Nikto with a scaly green face and a ring of small horns encircling his eyes. He studied her for an instant, then rasped,
"Wrong door, lady. Nothing inside to interest you."
Alima started to reach for the guard in the Force, but stopped when her danger sense grew so strong that her remaining leku began to tangle as well. She pointed her blowgun at the Nikto's feet, and using a Force suggestion to ensure he would obey, commanded,
"Wait."
The expression in the Nikto's eyes changed from threatening to surprised to obedient, and Alima extended her Force awareness in all directions. To her astonishment, she brushed a cold presence, something dark and bitter, back up the pedwalk near the bridge. But when she turned to look in that direction, the darkness vanished, and the danger tingle in her leku subsided as quickly as it had come. Alima continued to study the pedwalk for a few moments, trying to digest what she had felt. Someone was definitely stalking her, but it could hardly be Jason. Even had he been careless enough to let her detect him, and he wouldn't have been, the Jason she remembered was anything but bitter. Solemn and brooding, certainly, but also devoted and sincere. So who was stalking her? Alima turned back to the Nikto, gesturing past him with her blowgun.
"Did Jason Solo go in there?"
"Why would someone like that come here?"
The Nikto tried to sound uncertain, but Alima could sense his lie in the subtle tremor of his Force presence.
"There's nothing inside but housing."
"You dare lie to me?"
Alima used the Force to raise her crippled arm, then grabbed him by the throat.
"To a Jedi?"
Still calling on the Force, she lifted him off his feet and squeezed until she heard the happy crackle of crushed cartilage. The Nikto's mouth fell open, and a terrible gurgle came from his throat. Alima continued to hold him aloft until his eyes rolled back and his feet began kicking. Only when she sensed the other two guards stepping into the doorway did she drop the Nikto on the balcony and turn to find a pair of tentacle-faced Quarren bringing their old E-11 blaster rifles to bear. Alima waved her blowgun, using the Force to turn their weapons aside, then touched their minds with hers to search out the doubt she knew would be foremost in their thoughts, the fear that they could not stop her from entering, that they would be the ones who died.
"You do not need to die,"
Alima spoke in a Force whisper, so soft and compelling that it sounded like a thought.
"You do not need to stop anyone."
The guards relaxed.
"No one is coming through the door," she purred.
As Alima passed between the Quarren, she noticed that one of them had only three face tentacles. Their beady eyes began to focus on her, and their old E-11 blaster rifles started to swing back toward her. Alima tapped the muzzles of their weapons aside.
"You do not need to see me."
Their eyes grew unfocused again, and they turned their attention back to the door. Once Alima was safely inside, she faced the two Quarren.
"You know me well,"
she said, continuing to speak in her Force whisper.
"We have been talking for several minutes."
The Quarren shifted their stances, opening a place for Alima, and turned their heads slightly toward her. Now Alima spoke in her normal voice.
"Where do you suppose he was going?"
Three Tentacle turned to face her.
"Who, Solo?"
Alima nodded.
"Where do you think he was going?"
Three Tentacle retorted.
"To see it, of course."
"It? What are we talking about? Spice dens? Death games?"
Now the second Quarren turned toward her.
"Is that supposed to be a joke? He's here for the same reason everyone is. To see it. The friend."
"The friend, of course."
Alima knew the kind of friends males kept hidden in places like this. The kind they would dare visit only in the anonymous depths of an undercity. She pointed her blowgun out the door, gesturing at the fallen Nikto, then spoke in her Force whisper again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.